Galaxy S25 Ultra is out, and the trend was obvious from the very beginning. There is no focus on hardware upgrades, rather, Samsung decided to keep those upgrades incremental and focus on software improvements instead, as well as AI. I am Mo, and my line of research at university and also at work is on AI algorithms, and even I am sick of hearing this word. If you compare the Galaxy S25 Ultra to the Galaxy S24 Ultra, a few changes would give away which is which. There are rounded corners, which was something folks were complaining about, and it is a welcome change. Also, there is a new camera ring on the back, making the camera look larger. However, apart from the aesthetics, there has not been much of a change in the camera department. We have the same main sensor on the Galaxy S25 Ultra as the Galaxy S24 Ultra. The 3x and 5x telephoto sensors also stayed the same. The only change was the new ultra-wide sensor. We'll get into the camera comparison in a second. As I said, Samsung focused on software updates this year, and they introduced a new skin color science where the phone creates a better skin tone when you are taking photos indoor under artificial lights, which usually results in rather poor pictures. As far as I have tested, this feature can help, and you can get nice looking photos like this one. Or here on the new improved ultra-wide lens, you can see that the Galaxy S25 Ultra pictures are slightly better looking, with better colors and also pack more details compared to the S24 Ultra. On the main sensor, they both did pretty well, and I can't say either of them picked more details, but the color science is again different, and you can pick which one you prefer. I like this selfie photo on the S25 Ultra, where the skin tone is captured nicely under the purple light, and for the S24 Ultra, the iris skin tone is yellow. The selfie camera also stayed the same on the hardware side. Since many of you ask, I captured this photo while Daria was moving with the telephoto lens to see whether the pictures still get blurry in low light. You can judge by yourself whether they do or not. When it comes to video, there is a new computational videography feature where the phone tries to increase the clarity of the scene by denoising the subject while keeping the background intact. Here, I took a video from Daria to see this effect. I definitely do see that the shadows are raised on Daria, and there is a difference in video processing between S25 Ultra and S24 Ultra. But honestly, I cannot say that S25 Ultra is 100% looking better. Let me know what you think in the comments. Another feature that I've been waiting for a long time on the Galaxy Ultra series is lock. Basically, lock is a picture profile that looks very flat, because each shade of gray is of the same importance. The result will not look good straight out of the camera, but it gives you great flexibility to color grade your footage later. To be honest with you, I had a bit of a problem color grading this footage, but to be fair, the scene with so many unnatural lights was not helping either. Another camera feature that was a long wait is the newly improved filters, where you can select presets and change them as you want. This feature allows you to choose between filters similar to what we had before. The change is that now you can also define your filters, or you can play around with the existing ones and get the tone of the picture as you want. I covered it more on the Galaxy S25 base model video. Even though we got the improved ultra-wide sensor, we lost something. Now, the S Pen does not have Bluetooth functionality. At first, when I removed the S Pen and I tried to interact with it, I thought there was a software bug, but no. There really is no Bluetooth. Even though Android was a very niche feature, I still use the S Pen a lot for taking photos remotely. I'm gonna miss this, and I hope they don't further downgrade the S Pen and, God forbid, remove it for future generations. One big improvement from Galaxy S24 Ultra to Galaxy S25 Ultra is the new Galaxy Snapdragon 8 Elite chipset, which is a slightly overclocked version of the regular Snapdragon 8 Elite. We should see a big increase in efficiency. I have already tested the Snapdragon 8 Elite on multiple devices, and I'm pleased to say it is not only one of the best performing, but also one of the coolest chipsets out there. In my test, the Snapdragon 8 Elite used 10-20% less power in gaming and other heavy tasks. Also, when I tried to compare the OnePlus 13 with the Galaxy S24 Ultra, the Snapdragon 8 Elite had a much better single-core and multi-core performance than the S24 Ultra with the Snapdragon 8 Generation 3. In general, if you're a gamer or if you live in a hot climate, this is one of the best things that has happened on a smartphone for a very long time. Even on daily tasks comparing Galaxy S25 Ultra to Galaxy S24 Ultra, I did notice huge improvements in terms of the time the phone needed to process the pictures on S25 Ultra. One thing that Samsung kept is the anti-reflective display. The display has the same resolution as last year, but is slightly larger thanks to thinner bezels. Just to note that if you plan to apply the screen protector, you should only apply the anti-reflective screen protector from Samsung to keep the anti-reflective properties. Otherwise, you will negate this feature. It is better to go without a screen protector, but I personally hate micro scratches, so I would get a screen protector myself. The S25 Ultra panel is not the new M14 panel, so we have to test the potential grain issues and banding issues. The device that I tested didn't have those problems, but I should buy one myself before fully judging. There are also a few software improvements, but as I promised myself, I won't mention AI. The one that I see myself using is the new Now Bar, especially for listening to music or glancing into things on lock screen. Then there is a voice background eraser, which is again something nice to have, even though I would not use that feature. There is a dedicated button on the sidebar that you can use to select a section in the app, and the phone will give you suggestions on what to do with that section, like translating it for you if it is text or making a GIF if it's a video. It is context aware. Also, the battery capacity stays the same. It is at 5000 mAh battery. Of course, you are gonna get slightly better performance and also efficiency from a Snapdragon 8 Elite. So also the battery life is gonna improve, but not with a large margin like we've seen on OnePlus 13 or Vivo by 6000 mAh batteries. In general, there were a few things that they could improve on the hardware side, but they decided not to. We have this new battery technology that they could use. The other thing is that they could just use the new display, M14, that is from Samsung itself. It is quite a question mark for everyone. Why didn't they use such a thing? They could also improve the telephoto lens, for example. I really think it needs an improvement for a very long time. I think they are keeping it for Galaxy S26 Ultra series. In general, this launch was a bit of a bittersweet for me because on one hand, there are a few software features that I really like. For example, I was really looking forward for the lock feature. That's why I was using the Vivo in the past few months and also sometimes iPhone 16 Pro Max because I really want to color grade my footage when I want to post them online. On the other hand, on the hardware side, the battery capacity didn't improve. The display didn't improve. Nothing really improved. There was an ultra wide camera, but at the same time, the Bluetooth module is being removed from the S Pen. So it is a you get some, you lose some kind of a situation. And also, if you have the Galaxy S24 Ultra, you are gonna get all of those features anyway. Even if you have the Galaxy S23 Ultra, you're gonna get those features. And also the hardware is basically the same between S23, S24, and S25. So it's been 2 years that we really didn't see a big leap in development of phones. Another thing that is even for them was Qi2 support. They have Qi2 support, but they could also add a magnetic functionality on the back. I know it would be a bit difficult to do it with S Pen, but they could probably find a solution in engineering department or R&D. And that's it. That's all I have to say about the Galaxy S25 Ultra. If you enjoyed this video, I made a video comparing Galaxy S25 versus Galaxy S24 base models. Thanks for tuning into Techmo, and I will see you in the next one.